this is Jan. Jan, this is Charlie. Yeah.
Hi, nice Jan. To meet you.
There you go. You can join us if you want.
You can't vote, and neither can I.
Perfect.
Dad can't vote. No.
Level playing field, finally, with Dad.
The alternate two.
This is Chatfield.
So when we go camping, we camp right there.
Wow.
And I didn't bring a cup.
Isn't that a reservoir? So,
yeah, well, that's Chatfield Reservoir. When we did the cleanup of the trash, that was right here.
Power dinner is.
Oh, yes.
The sauce dribbles down your shirt.
Gymnastics is like.
Pretty good. Mm-hmm.
My dry cleaner calls these bibs for men.
Oh.
Because it catches all the stuff.
Oh, I had this invention, speaking of the bibs. It's called the tie bib. Okay,
yeah.
So you got your tie on. And then in the back it has a few snaps. And when you're dining, you unfold it.
Just the same thing flip as last time we had the plastic.
We've lost two.
Don, you fold it back up.
Meeting notes from the retreats.
And then also, it's worth $1 million.
Same thing
with
email. Oh,
type it. Isn't it cool? When you're done, you.
And the thought is, we've got.
Fold it back
when am I going to be coming?
Go back to work.
Yeah, we'll break it into groups of three, basically. And we can only get the first hour.
No? So. About my age.
And what we're going to do is.
The old.
Something that I use by yourself.
10 or 11. Yeah. Like.
Boy Scouts invented it, I think, with, you know, the three or four beer lunches back in the days when you drank at lunch and you'd stay awake in the afternoon.
And you didn't want to come back to the office looking like...
What change? Age? Just on the
Southern traditions. There's this really cool sculpture, steel structure going on. It's really, and then there's a rendering on the south side that shows me.
Yeah, it's starting to build in.
Well, they bought this great big altar. The priest, Father Jackson, went to Europe and they bought this humongous altar that they basically had to build this church.
Around the altar.
They had to adjust the height of it. I mean, even they even had to do a little more adjustment on the height because of that altar. But they finally got it. They remeasured.
That's impressive. Because usually the furnishings are like the.
Well, the church is there. It looks like some. Well, it was a church there, so some of the outbuildings are still. They kept it. Looks like there's a remodel. You know, classroom building and all the space. And then you have the sanctuary.
Okay, shall we get started? Andrew has to leave a little early, so I haven't really scheduled to start until 6:15, so you could all get something to eat. But welcome to this special session of the Littleton Planning Board. Dennis, could you do the roll call, please?
Board Member Coronado.
Here.
Board Member Drazen.
Here.
Board Member Elrod.
Here.
Board Member Graham.
Here.
Board Member Metcalf, Board Member Ranville.
Here.
Board Member Radicki.
Here.
Board Member Samuelson.
Here.
We have a quorum.
Okay, great. Well, thank you. So the agenda calls for presentation of sort of summary of what was presented at Euclid, Goddard, and the Littleton Center. And as you know, they were all different presentations, and I don't think all of us were at any of them, so I think we'll all benefit from that. Dennis has about a half hour on the agenda for that and thinks it may go quicker. I know.
Or longer, eventually. I'm not sure.
It depends on how much questions we have during the process, and feel free to input it, but also I'd like to make sure that Andrew has an opportunity to participate in a little bit of the mapping exercise, which will occur after that, and he has to leave at 7. So. Once Dennis gives his presentation, then we'll break out into two groups, which are really the two halves of the table, I think, as you envisioned it. We have some maps out here, and we're going to identify some key transformative or catalytic projects in Littleton based on our work session a few Saturdays ago, and then come back together and sort of present them to each other and hopefully come out with some consensus as to what can inform the plan. And then we'll wrap up and adjourn that. So with that, Dennis, I'll let you get
going. Thank you. So we'll be on TV for this first portion during the presentation. When you go into the actual study session, we're actually going to turn off the sound because it's just going to be a little chaotic, I think, in terms of the sound. When we come back together to give the presentation from each of the small groups, we'll come back on live again so the audience at home will be able to hear that. So.
And I should add that there were two parts of the agenda that we didn't cover at the retreat. This is the first of those two parts that we'd like to get through tonight. And then on December 10th, hoping that we can all do the same three-hour session, that we'd be able to go through the goals and policies discussion, prioritize those.
So the first session we did was Littleton by the Numbers, and we talked about population and housing. This was at Powell Middle School. And we talked about Littleton's population by age. And I think most of you have seen part of this at least, and that was we've got numbers on the left, and we've got age breakdowns by 5 years, every 5 years on the bottom. Starting off in 1980, kind of start to see where the peak is. You kind of see teenage years is kind of where we're looking at in terms of where the real peak is on that. And then it moves forward a little bit for 1990. Moves ahead again for 2000, and ahead again for 2010. And by 2000 and 2010, we actually have kind of secondary little peaks in there as well. So it looks like what's happening is we've got the peak age group getting older. 1980, it's 18 to 19. 1990, it's 30 to 34. 2000, 40 to 44. And because we're getting those peak years up in the childbearing ages, we're having a secondary peak of being the kids coming from those childbearing families. Population by age, again, the number of people in the oldest age category is growing faster than the population as a whole. For example, 85 plus, kind of see where it stands as a percentage of the population as a whole. It goes from 1.25% in 1980 to 2.62% in 2012. So it's increasing faster than any of the other age groups. The median age is increasing as well, again, from 1980 to 2010, 31, 35, 38, and 41 for each of those 10-year periods. You're seeing the median age increasing. And Littleton population, you can read this a couple different ways, but I think what you can see is you still see some growth in 80 to 90. It starts to level out in 90 to 2000, 2010. So it's being destabilized, 28,000, 34,000, 40,000, and then just a 2,000 people increase between 2000 and 2012. Household size in Littleton, average household size is decreasing again. 2.65 down to 2.25. And average household income is decreasing as well, which is surprising, I think, in terms of what's happening with the region as a whole. And we've got different theories. I think when we had this discussion before, is it simply the economy, or is it a factor that we've got this aging population and therefore people are retiring and losing at least one primary income? Household income in Littleton going from $20,500 to $53,000 in 2012, a drop from 66,000 in 2000.
But that is region-wide. You don't see that same trend decreasing?
We do not. In fact, yeah, we'll actually show you that here in a couple of slides. Craig, thanks. Owners and renters, fairly stable in terms of the percentage, with the blue-gray being the owner-occupied and the renter-occupied being that kind of burnt orange tan. The trend ratio of owner-occupied to renter-occupied housing units has remained largely the same. It's about 58% in 1990 to 61% in 2010. So a little bit of increase, but not huge.
The owner being the owner-occupied being the first number?
Yes.
On both? Okay. So it has increased.
Right. The owner-occupied has increased. I'm sorry. The owner-occupied was the first one. Residential additions and remodels. If you look at this map, there are two different figures on here. One is smaller remodelings and additions, under 30,000, and the darker dots are the larger than $30,000 per individual remodel and addition. And you kind of look at, see where the concentrations of those are. It's not where one might assume initially, which would be in the older neighborhoods. It tends to be in the neighborhoods which are beginning to age a little bit. They're 10, 15, 20 years old. They're not the 40, 50, 60-year-old neighborhoods themselves.
So could lot size be a driver?
Lot size can be a driver for that, I think, in terms of the additions particularly. I think it's also some of the more expensive housing I think people are investing in, as opposed to the more affordable housing, probably not investing as much because of the return and potential there.
Related to clusters, that because there's more density there may be more clusters of dots?
Probably driven more by affluence than cluster. And then to cluster, though, and I'm sorry to interrupt, Kurt, are there any holes on here that is not a park, that is a region that is not getting developed?
It probably...
That's Kettering Park, right?
Right.
You've got some holes that are commercial, too.
We have some commercial holes, South Park. We may not see the more expensive ones in South Park neighborhood itself, residential neighborhood. Again, maybe because the lots are smaller.
South Park is a newer home, so they're not going to be remodeling and adding on until...
Well,
they're older than over at Polo Reserve.
Polo Reserve, yeah. So the Polo Reserve is, a larger lot, probably.
Wasn't that almost like a redevelopment? Was it ranches, and then they turned it into...
No, it was uh-huh. Brand new development. Yeah, brand new construction.
Time, what's the window of that? Is that 1 year? Is that a 2 year period?
I think 10 years actually.
A 10 year period. So that's from
2000 to 2010. Yeah.
That's a large time frame.
It's a large time frame. And I guess I'm a little surprised that we didn't see a little bit more distribution of that, in some other areas. Because we have seen, even in some of the areas that aren't showing up, we've seen some pops and scrapes and some flips at least. You know,
but
some
it's
areas.
Not include new construction. It's
no,
just
no.
Remodeling.
Just remodeling of existing houses.
Somebody over the reserve had a large deck, it could be 50,000, 60,000.
Right, sure could, absolutely. And then I think Andrew's right in terms of a lot of the houses probably pretty much filled up the lot in terms of what's allowed on that lot. If there's the smaller lot, so. Revenue and employment. We talked about it at Euclid. This is interesting, I think, to a lot of people. I think most of you are going to be familiar with this as well, just because this is the city's sales and use tax receipts. And kind of blow that up a little bit. You kind of see that blue, the large, almost half, is retail and sales tax and use tax. See, it's retail trade. So
what's the
huge first chunk of our income is from that? I'm sorry.
So what's the bright blue? Can't read.
The large
information.
Yeah. So that would be like utilities, telecommunication, use tax, sales tax, both.
And that light green, that other big wedge.
Accommodations and food service.
Thank you. Yes, I can see. It doesn't show up on
there.
Yeah, really. Yeah, so food services is a huge one, I think, for us.
And how's that trending? Did that last slide show
previous?
No, it did not. This is the same one. This is just blown up from the last one. So the trend, my understanding is that it's fairly consistent. I don't think we've seen a huge change in this over time. We didn't actually show a trend on that one. The other thing that people found kind of interesting, I think, was just there's a perception that their property tax goes to the city, and it really doesn't. So this is just a breakdown of where property taxes go. 64.5% go to the school district, 18.3% go to the county, and only 7.5% goes to the city. So about the same as goes to South Suburban. So I think that's surprising to a lot of people when they realize, again, just the significance of the retail and use tax to the city in terms of income source.
We don't pay any RTD?
No, not in terms of retail and sales tax. We say it's property tax only. Or excuse me, just the opposite. I'm sorry, not property tax, it's only sales and sales tax. Sales tax goes to an RTD at this point. They do have a slot in it about holding place where at some point. I guess so. At some point they may. Right now they have it, yeah. This is the way the city breaks up the different retail sales tax districts within the city. As you can imagine, number one, which includes Aspen Grove, is a large revenue generator for the city. Number seven, which is the city downtown, downtown really has shown the largest increase of any of the districts in the city in the last 5 years, the highest percentage increase. You kind of see where the rest of them are. Number four, other than what's along the corridors, really doesn't have much. Number three is primarily where the employment base is at South Park. Number two is the hospital district. Number five has the new car dealerships. And so it's kind of spread out that way. Number nine is primarily residential as well. So there's a fairly large discrepancy between the highest and lowest.
Is a ranking of how?
No, this is really, actually, this is random. This is just numbers that they go by. And you can actually track this by how are they doing year by year. And that's about as they break down a little bit more than this, but they try and aggregate them as much as possible just so you don't pick out an individual business and say, we know how that business is doing. They try and maintain that privacy.
What do the colors represent?
They're totally random, just to distinguish.
Because you've got the industrial park down in the south corner on the fourth. County Line in Santa Fe is the industrial park.
Right.
That's an employment center.
County Line, Santa Fe. Where are you?
South Corner.
You're right there.
Oh, right there, yeah. Yeah, it's just part of the district, yeah. So those are the large districts that they just just combine all the
pieces with. But the sales tax rate is the same between
the districts? Yeah, it sure is. It sure is, absolutely. And less, it sure is in this case.
So Aspen Grove doesn't have an additional, sometimes they, developments have an additional tax.
They have a business improvement district. They pay that through the property tax, I believe.
In our last meeting, one of the patrons said they paid a higher tax. Was that implying what you just said?
I would think so.
People living in a lot of places talking about a higher tax in their region.
Well, remember who that was, because I wasn't at that meeting.
I don't remember the man. But
was it a resident or a business owner?
It was a resident. Okay. Says we pay a higher tax in this region.
For the property tax?
For his property
tax. Well, like a Trailmark, they have a metropolitan district there. So that actually is the highest, and that's probably the largest percentage of their property tax goes to their metro district.
And that's primarily for new infrastructure? So the real advantage of living in a developed city like Littleton is that most of your infrastructure has already been paid for at one point. And so if you move to a new development, if you move to Castle Pines or you move to Highlands Ranch, you're paying for that through special districts.
Are they paying off the bonds that they took out?
They're paying off those bonds, exactly, yeah.
How much longer won't that eventually pay off?
It will, yeah. Typically it pays off in 20 years, I think, or 20 or 30, something like that. So, yeah. Jan, do you remember exactly
how many years on that, but there's also,
So, it depends on the
Once their bonds paid off, their tax rate will drop.
Typically come down, exactly, right. Yeah.
And Aspen Grove, did you use a tax increment finance?
No, sure did not. No, we've never... As far as I know, the city of Littleton's never used a tax increment financing for any projects. Remember anything, Jan, ever? No. The significance of primarily that was just to kind of, again, point out that, you know, we do have some revenue from property tax, but our real revenue source is retail. And retail really is our revenue source. And it's the significance of that in terms of why you keep hearing us harp on retail for that. The other part of the formula, one part of the formula, is employment. And Littleton's in a unique situation in terms of how we stand compared to the region as a whole. And we'll show you those numbers, but at the same time, get back to the numbers Craig was looking at. You can kind of see this in the trend data. The people is the purple, and the jobs is the green. And you can kind of see until 2006, the number of jobs was increasing faster than the number of people. Looks like it's pretty much parallel at this point in terms of increasing at the same rate, at least up until that's the projection, the current as well as projection. This is where I think I was referencing earlier, Craig, was that if you look at our jobs and population ratio, Littleton on the left and the region on the right, we have a ratio of 1.3 jobs for every two people. The region's 0.95 jobs for every two people. So we have almost half again as many jobs per person as the region as a whole does. unemployment rate is lower as well, 6.9% as opposed to 8.1% last May. And then estimated 2011 per capita income. Ours is a little higher again, 33,530 compared to 31. But then our median family income was actually lower, 54,155 versus 58,979. So we are actually a little lower in that case than the region as a whole. This is interesting, only just in terms of kind of what you already know is where the jobs are. And the map's off a little bit in terms of the way it reads things. So the dark blob is kind of where it's concentration of jobs. So you're seeing the hospital district and South Park on the south. You're seeing Aspen Grove. And then you're seeing the county, city, ACC towards the north. Probably should be shifted a little bit to the left there, but that's from where it actually reads. And then also kind of the percentages of, you see all the different job types, job sources that are the actual numbers there. And this, again, is worker distribution. Where do workers live? And again, kind of where you'd anticipate. A pretty high concentration, kind of the northeast neighborhood and through the older neighborhoods, where we have more multiple family, and including multiple family down in South Park. And then where we have larger lots, you get the lighter color. So, and along the river, you have a very light color.
So Dennis, mm-hmm. I'm just kind of curious. The maps are great, and I was curious, what program did you or get the data from or retrieve that from? I was just curious.
Eric gets all this for us, and I believe this is, you know, we subscribe to a data source, and I don't remember which one this is, unfortunately, but I can find out for you, definitely, so great. If you're interested. The next one actually is one of my favorites, because I think this is maybe more telling than anything. This is import-export, and just like you import retail dollars and export retail dollars in terms of where you're buying, who you're selling to, this is also jobs inflow and outflow. We're actually importing more employees than we're exporting. We're importing 25,000 people to work in the city of Littleton, and we export 17,000 people to work outside of Littleton. And then actually 2,300 actually work in Littleton, so live here and work here. And this is kind of, we've got two of these, which kind of say chaos, but yeah. Ask Eric again, because I know that's one of the things that he's going to be looking for as well. Because I think it's something we really need to know. And it's one of the questions. It's really essential to us, I think. You know, and what sectors are they spending in? Or are we spending in, you know, when we spend outside the city? So it's one thing that if we don't have that, I think we want to look at. The next two are kind of like chaos maps, but they This one I think is interesting just because this is a work location for Littleton residents. If you look over on the right hand, I don't know if you can read that, but 27% of people who live in Littleton and work outside of the city work in Denver. 12% of the people who live in Littleton work in Littleton. And then we have the opposite side of that is people who work in Littleton come in from outside. I mean, it's 15% live in Denver, come in, 9.6% live in Centennial, and then spread out throughout. So it's kind of what you expect, I think, in terms of where people are going, where they're coming from. Employment by industry, not unusual, perhaps, based on the region, and Littleton are fairly, we're very much a service sector region, and that's kind of what we are locally as well. Question, and we asked these questions of Chuck and of Tom when they were at the retreat. In order to have a financially healthy city, what's the appropriate ratio between jobs and people? Tom's answer was it depends. Every city's going to be different in terms of what you're looking at. But it strikes me that if you look at Greenwood Village, they have a huge disproportionate share of people who work in the city, much larger than they actually have who live there. It's like three or four times the number of people work in the city more than actually live there. That's really unusual to have that much of a disproportionate. Cherry Hill's on the other side. Nobody works there. Everybody lives there. So it goes back and forth depending on the city. But it seems like it should, and I guess it would kind of what Tom's answer was, you just keep adjusting to see what your needs are. But it probably doesn't have as much influence on us other than the fact that that's the source of the jobs is where we get our use taxes because you're assuming you're buying equipment, you're buying product, and so you get use tax. And then you also have a source for your retail sales tax. So you have people who are eating and shopping in the city if you have people working in the city. And then we also don't have a number of kind of what you're getting to, Karina, to what kind of retail do we need? What's the ideal for us in terms of what would be ideal to maintain that kind of sustainable economy for the city? As it goes over time. Mark has pointed out, I think, in this context and a couple other contexts, and that you all have discussed this as well, that this evolves over time. All this stuff evolves. So it's this cycle that you go through. So you can't ever just pinpoint it at one point. You're always kind of constantly adjusting.
Chris? You talked about Greenwood Village. Would that be anywhere near that amount if they hadn't annexed most of the Denver Tech Center and Flagpole around the whole road and took all the commercial?
No, not at all. No, I don't think they had, I can't remember that they had anything before that, really.
Very little. So that's where all their workers come.
Right, exactly,
So the statement prior to this said, in order to have a financially healthy city, so with that really, so the question that I have there is what makes us stronger financially? And I think the answer is sales tax revenue, right? Because that really does, a lot of it does come to the city versus the property tax. Mm-hmm. A smaller percentage of property tax comes to the city. So it's, if we had to choose, not that we're choosing, because one is related to the other, we would want to bring more purchasers to the city, which doesn't necessarily mean we want more people living in the city.
Right. Although I think what Tom was saying was that in order to have a healthy, kind of sustainable retail, you need to have that that set of rooftops. You need to have people living there as well as that sustainable market. If you just were, if you were a Cinderella city and you've got a huge, million square foot shopping center that doesn't have the residential base to it, that can go away at some point, as Cinderella City did very quickly, from being the largest shopping center on this side of the Mississippi to being absolutely nothing. So you need to have, again, figure out how all this work together, I think. So, Jen?
And then also thinking about the cycles and the fluctuation of our age demographics. We've got these long cycles, and that if we can have more of a various age, younger, continue to keep having young families come into our city, that we can perhaps shorten our cycle so it isn't so long.
Right.
And I think that will also help with some of the retail and the sales tax. And so keeping a healthy businesses.
Right. And again, I think it's kind of similar thing, I think, is if you have that kind of mixture of retail uses, then you again have that flexibility. You have to have flexibility to adjust to different market trends and different to whatever might be into to what the economy is. So adjusting as quickly as you can, being kind of quick on your feet. So, Mark.
Yeah, but you know, it's my theory that eventually those big giant bumps level out because of we're all not getting out of this life alive. So there's deaths. It tends to level out. People move sooner. So eventually, you get a blend that stays fairly constant. Might be some slight blips.
Yeah, I think that's true. I think the challenge is going to be is that if we drop off so far that there's nobody in the schools, and then the interest in schools drops to such a point that you don't have the quality schools we've had historically.
Of course, it hasn't happened.
Then you don't continue to attract that younger family that you might want. So to maintain that, I think you have to think about how those things even out at some point. How do you keep all that stuff kind of juggling?
I think it'll even out just naturally on its own. We can help it along a little bit, but it'll naturally level out regardless of what we do.
Yeah, I think
but keeping your services, like we're losing our grocery stores, and there's different things that start getting cut if you don't get that mix of residents.
I'm saying we need to push, pull, and do all kinds of things, but there's some natural forces here.
There are some natural forces.
I wouldn't all panic because of the aging population. It won't last forever.
You just have to make sure that as the population is aging, it's being replaced, we're retaining the quality of our neighborhoods, retaining the quality of the schools, so that younger families who can afford to shop, can move in. So you get that balance again. You get the diversity of economic levels.
The city to panic and do something where it doesn't require a panic mode.
Right, exactly. Yeah. So this is the same one we saw before. This is the presentation we had at Goddard. I think some of you have seen this as well.
Safeway.
What are the buildings? This is the Safeway one, exactly. So these are all Safeways. So all seven of those buildings were Safeways, and all seven are in Littleton. This is the current Safeway. It's number 8. But the question is, when you start looking at it, is how long is this one going to last? And what's going to replace it? And what do you want to replace it? What's the ideal? So.
And that was on the site of a prior Safeway. Wasn't there a Safeway on that site before it was redeveloped?
It had a movie theater, and there was a Tony's Meats.
The movie theater was over on the north side, right? Northeast corner?
Retail.
Just in-line retail? Yeah.
Take about 8 stores and then move some of the people out of the Tony's in there.
Okay. So why does retail evolve? We talked about this. Safeway experienced competition, a shift in demand and quantity and quality, a shift in traffic patterns, and other things probably too. They really said that we need to build a new store. The median age increasing, the average household size decreasing meant that suddenly that house full of teenage kids you had who were eating everything that they could find in sight, suddenly it was down to 2 people not eating nearly as much, and so Safeway said, well, the market's not here anymore. Household income changing, and traffic patterns changing too. And whereas Bellevue at one point actually went through Beaumar, it really, de facto, dead ends at Beaumar at this point. So the traffic pattern changed, and then suddenly we had competition to the west on West Bowles, and Santa Fe opened up as a very different street than it had been before. So traffic patterns change, and along with that, the market changes too. And then the other part of that is that we can't think of ourselves in this vacuum. We really are part of a much larger region that, we're affected by what Sheridan has built with their Super Target and their Costco, and we're affected by streets of Southland, and we're affected by what goes out into Jefferson County. So it's a much larger area we have to actually consider as we're looking at what happens to retail. Evolution can involve a change in solution, a change in scale, a change in use, or a change in design, as evidenced by the King Supers at Bellevue and Federal. And suddenly we've got a whole new building going in. So what are the best uses? That's a question that you guys are going to be faced with as this continues. What are the best uses for these sites? If they're no longer the highest and best use, Is that okay, or is there another use that really should be encouraged there? And how do you make that happen? Or how do you encourage that to happen? Or how do you facilitate that happen? Because there are a whole different ways of doing it. So you can, change will happen. It either happens on its own, one can help direct change. Zoning is probably the tool that you guys are certainly most familiar with, and we all are, that most communities use. It addresses land use and minimum lot size and lot width and setbacks and open space and height, all the key essentials of what a building looks like and how it sits on the site. This is our zoning. It's pretty consistent and pretty with what the existing land use pattern is. It's a pretty simple zoning pattern, pretty logical. We've got most of our commercial uses along the transportation corridors, higher densities and pockets around a little bit. And then we've got some industrial down to the south.
And the beige color on there is a mixed use zone?
The beige color in there is, yes, is the CA, which is mixed use. Correct. A question, is our current zoning as effective as it might be at directing the evolution of land uses? Well, I think you guys can answer that more than most people can probably in terms of, are we achieving what we want with zoning and what needs to be done to it? Does it accurately reflect the best land uses for each area of the city, the appropriate quantity of each land use, what buildings should look like, how tall they should be, any other concerns that you think need to be addressed? How active should the city be in trying to direct the evolution of land uses? It's one of the questions we've been asking on the city's Inspire website, and we've gotten a pretty positive response in terms of, yes, the city should be involved in trying to shape the pattern of land uses, the location of retail, attracting people to the city that we think would be beneficial to the city. Are there other land use tools that we should be using? Principle number 4, it's not just retail uses that evolve. Residential evolves. And this is looking at kind of densities. The darker or more dense areas that at one point were, lower density and have just over time built out to more intense densities. Questions that we've asked regarding retail uses should also be asked about residential uses, as well as industrial and other commercial. Retail evolves, evolution can involve a change of location. Communities can either let change happen or they can help direct it. And it's not just retail. So the questions are, what's the lifespan of current uses? What should replace them if they do go away? Is our current zoning as effective as it might be? Does our current zoning accurately reflect the best land uses for each area of the city? How active should the city be? And are there other land use tools that we should be using? So that was kind of what we presented at the forums. And generated great conversation. We really had some good conversations going on. I think it was really worthwhile, I think, to have this kind of information and hear what people were saying. So it was great.
Yeah, that's good.
Can you please email that deck?
Sure, you betcha. Mm-hmm. One way or another, yeah, I'll get it to you.
It's probably a big file, right? I'm wondering if you might want to add one question at the end. Do uses matter? When you talk about form-based code, uses don't, they still matter, but they don't matter as much.
That's right.
Absolutely. And I think that's the other tools. Should we be going to form-based instead?
I think that's one thing we want to think about as we go through these exercises is what is our zoning, I think that was one of the questions up there, is the zoning that we have, are the zoning tools that we have now adequate in this day and age? When we know there's other types of tools that are out there. I'd like to get into this mapping exercise because I think it would be really useful and it will be fun. And one of the things, just to kind of set it up for you, I put together from the agenda of the retreat, the goal here was to identify Littleton's challenges and top transformative actions, I think was what was on the agenda. And so think of it that's what we should focus on today. What I got out of both the presentations from Tom and Chuck and our homework assignments and sharing those and then going back through and trying to identify commonalities in them were several trends, and I wrote them down here. the trends are, you know, sort of a trend toward urban living and more tolerance of density, that we live in a maturing community which faces infill and redevelopment challenges, that we have an aging population as part of a larger cycle, that people want choices of housing and access, easy access to amenities, that people want transportation choices. They want to be able to either drive or walk or bike or take transit, and that that quality of life is driving people's choices of where to live and work. So quality of life is an important factor. And then I think, you know, again, coming out of our shared presentations, the catalytic sites or projects that I heard most come up were the EchoStar site at Bowles and Santa Fe, kind of extending Main Street across Santa Fe, the Enser property as sort of a TOD type of development, Littleton Boulevard as Littleton's Main Street or an extension of Littleton's Main Street again, the Broadridge Center, and also sort of as a prototype or precedent for other redeveloping strip centers. The Broadridge came up in several of the presentations. The South Platte River as something that we should orient toward instead of away from. Broadway as a better sort of urban corridor with updating land uses and design of the corridor. The Marathon site is one of the few infill sites remaining. And then the idea of connecting greenways, linking parks and trails and creeks together. Those were just, and there were more ideas than that, but those were the ones that showed up at least in two or three different presentations and seemed to have some commonalities. So with that, I guess we could break out into two.
One group of four, one group of three, with Andrew being in the group of four.
I think the idea is to take those ideas and others, look at the map. What opportunities are, I think, outside the box? You know, what other opportunities are there? I'd like to throw out the idea. I mean, do we want to look at annexation as an opportunity? It's a visionary plan, right?
You want to pick Andrew's brain a little bit before he takes off? He and Charlie have to leave here, I should say.
I loved the idea of the river being the center hub of everything that we're doing. It just made such logical sense to me. And especially given that the feedback that we're getting orients towards a more outdoor Littleton. As I'm looking here, and granted it's the perspective I have, these are reservoirs, but they're beautiful areas. And ways that we could take advantage of the non-developed land, but yet orient towards those. One thing I never understood is why Columbine Valley is its own town. But that's probably a different discussion. And then at the end of the day, I'd also like to create a ring of commerce. If our infill is primarily in 80120, then Littleton Boulevard to Santa Fe to Mineral and back over, and see if we can populate all of that with business development. Focusing most of the restaurant traffic and residential traffic along the river to try to make that as cool as we could possibly make it. It's just this general theme, and I'm actually sad not to be here to hack this up with you. But that's kind of the main thing. But any place that everybody has access to sports and recreation, I absolutely want to see much more arts championed, and specifically performing artists, whether they be musicians or artisans or painters or whatever, but a draw. We don't have a Gothic. We don't have an Ogden. We don't have a Broomfield Event Center to draw from, and I think we're missing out on a tremendous opportunity to bring that talent in because it brings people back into where we're at. So those are sort of the main things. Oh, and since I'm babbling, I'd like to see, and I don't really know what I mean by this yet, but I'd like to see ACC stay on ACC. And it's, I guess that relates specifically to downtown. ACC is a great contributor to our neighborhood and a big asset to everything we have. But yet, for example, the art school that they have, that art center, is taking up prime office space that hurts downtown's ability to bring restaurants in or keep them in a consistent flow, you know, meaning lunch and dinner in the same, because the students primarily come in and leave. And then to that end, given that ACC is such a great asset, get more, and I'll just call them hot dog stands, right around there that cater towards people who don't have a lot of money that need a quick meal, or a coffee shop, or things that colleges like to have, and really capitalize on what they're offering.
Okay.
So thank you, Craig.
Well, good. Yeah, we'll make sure we incorporate that thinking into.
I have 14 pages of bullets that I can email you.
please do. Okay. All right. I guess you know, maybe it's 3 and 3 then.
Yeah.
Here and Jen and.
We'll break up and. We could do it one of two ways. We can actually be recorders for you if you'd like, or if you want to record your own. I think one of you should be doing the presentation. The idea is that each group will come up with your own set of ideas in terms of what you see as the key constraints, key opportunities, key catalytic actions, and then you'll get back together and try and convince the other that you've got the key ones. And come up with a single list tonight, that kind of a consensus in terms of what you see are the top five of each of those, or however you want to do that.
Oh, you want to try to narrow it to top five, or just whatever you want?
I think the smaller the better. I think, particularly when you get to catalytic actions, the smaller the number, the better.
Okay.
But, yeah, so.
Okay, these aren't etchings. We get to write on this?
We get to write on these, absolutely.
Right,
and you've got maps here as well. You've got both just line drawing maps as well as this map. Those, and you should have some pins, and so.
Are these copies of the same
thing? They're the same thing, yeah, exactly. I just gave you multiple copies in case you wanted to draw on a couple of them. Keep at least one so that we actually have a final product for each group, I think. And it could be a combination of.
We'll stay with blue. I think what we do is just scribble on one and then maybe clean it up before we present.
much don't expect. Woodlawn, downtown. This one, I think there's another one that's missing over here. Aspen Grove. So, and we've also identified them sort of as, you know, neighborhood-oriented versus regionally-oriented. The only ones that really kind of rose to the regional level were Aspen Grove and downtown, which also can serve a neighborhood. But this is clearly a regional feel to it. So, and then we drew sort of a quarter to half mile rough circle radius for walking distance. And you can see right away that there's a lot of areas here that are sort of underserved in terms of walkable urban areas, and we were even looking, you know, is there any place in here where it would be appropriate, but there's not really a seed for that. There's not a place or a place that might generate that. But there is this sort of underutilized shopping center along Mineral that we thought could grow and serve and fill a gap here so that you have better sort of a ring around the area. Then we now we started to focus on green space, especially the major green spaces, the South Platte River as a place where we can sort of reorient development toward, and you know, really looking at how much open space there is here that most of us didn't know was there, and you know, how do you make that more accessible visually and physically here. And if we had more time, I would have probably drawn the sort of tributaries like Little Creek and so on going into there, which you probably so that's important in terms of, you know, providing access to some of these developments. And then these orange areas are some of those catalytic sites. We wouldn't get them all, but we tried to start prioritizing, you know, the ENSER property and the ULI study that identified it really more of a larger site that includes the existing station and Aspen Grove. As a redevelopment project, this one probably being second priority is the EchoStar property, and mainly because it serves a whole bunch of functions. It really is an identity thing for Littleton. It extends Main Street. It makes better connections from downtown to the river. It's highly visible. There's a number of different aspects. So these arrows really indicate, you know, sort of that extension of Main Street, extension of the Prince Street as well, as those corridors that define downtown. And
yeah, I think we really just grouped them. It's three, right? So it's three priorities here. It's really this area here as a truly big and broad redevelopment and new area for Littleton. That is going to be another defining component of Littleton, just like downtown Littleton is. Then second is the expansion of downtown Littleton. We already have an asset to work with. We've expanded more and utilized the river to build on that expansion, the idea of a riverfront there. And then the third priority is really identifying these nucleus neighborhoods that will naturally help build and develop the neighborhood, starting with the center point of a retail, shopping area, neighborhood shopping area. So by developing this, you naturally improve and develop the surrounding area around it. So I think that would be kind of, so it would be one, two, and three. We also looked at this as effort and impact. This really is the biggest impact, but also the biggest effort. And so it's really about a long-term strategy there.
You rated them 1, 2, 3 in order or importance?
It was a little bit of, it was, I think impact would probably be the biggest driver of that rating.
Okay.
So this really is one as priority, but it's also recognized as a very long-term strategy and a significant effort in order to accomplish this because of all the complexities associated with this. This is more near term. Second priority, again, big impact because we already have something to build off of. So I think the impact will be realized sooner. Some level of effort, but at least we have really one owner that we're dealing with here as opposed to potentially multiple here. And then third would be this one that is probably little effort and less of an impact. So that's kind of my priority.
Would on being the hub?
Yeah. thinking about Woodlawn being the hub and creating mixed use, and then naturally there's just an opportunity for the residential to develop better and further, as we can see some historic preservation properties around the area could really be an extension of the character of downtown, as neighborhood linked to downtown.
So some zoning along there that could help with the density.
Exactly.
But without losing sight of this
sure.
developable
yeah.
plot here with Marathon, that could be more of a regional center.
I think some of this is going to, not that it's going to happen on its own, but this is a little bit easier to allow to happen, whereas I think here we really have to push more proactively to make happen as we want.
I guess one of the criteria that I kind of held to these two was that they affect area within Littleton, whereas like these edge properties, even Marathon, you know, a lot of it is helping Centennial, not Centennial. I mean, there's more bang for the buck in terms
of
Littleton.
Centennial come and give us money.
But yeah, it's drawing
wall.
It's drawing tax revenue rather than that sucking sound you hear when they go to
Scotland. I think what we need to remember is Marathon's the easier site to develop.
Yeah.
And so it's probably in the wings already.
Yeah.
And so what's probably going to happen just because of shopping dynamics is if Marathon does develop along Broadway, some retail / office. Don't hold your breath for Bridge Road or Mentor on Broadway to redevelop, because all the dollars are going to go to Marathon.
Yeah,
and all the shopping.
My thought here was this would be great for residential with very limited retail.
Right.
So
there's also the economies of scale. If something happens at Marathon, other businesses, secondary businesses, might redevelop in those areas too, but it'll be a long time.
Are you familiar with what's happening at Kent Place over there in Hampton University?
Yeah.
And I can see this being a smaller version.
That was a condo project.
Is that even condos at all? There's all commercial. What's all commercial about?
Yeah.
Commercial be
well,
like,
well, there's commercial on the corner, but it's mostly residential. The project itself. That's interesting. Wasn't that supposed to be a mid-rise one time?
Yeah, it was going to be a mid-rise condo project.
Yeah, that got redesigned.
There was some residential actually north of it, and they bought that out. There was two or three houses in there. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's what it was. Center.
There's still residential going to be west of that?
Yeah, most, if the plan is similar, actually, a triple was working on that. If the plan is similar to what I originally saw, it was mostly three-quarters of the site was residential, just the corner of the University of London was going to wrap with retail. And they even have the new
supermarket.
A little closer, it looks like a lot more commercial.
I think it's about half and half.
A lot commercial. Really, I'll have to.
I don't think there's that much left in
the
behind there that we could do much in residential. It's about half.
Unless they go vertical.
Yeah, go vertical. But as far as the use of the land, I think it's about half.
Commercial, it's a lot more than Virginia.
Yes, it was.
Yeah, I thought it was just a little strip development along the University, but it goes back. Commercial office goes back. Looks like a couple of places are maybe open by now.
Oh, really?
Kind of. The times are up.
Coming close, yeah. They're getting really close.
A lot of cars on that lot. Maybe all workers.
I think there's all workers right now, but I think it's going to be. I go by there almost.
Yeah, I went by today. Should be.
Any other questions or comments on this?
So,
I like the. The influence area around the nodes,
yes.
Because that is what tends to happen. Is if you get some activity going, hopefully it bleeds out into other areas adjacent to it. You know, and so, because really, what we're going to get are specific sites that hopefully we develop, not entire areas. So, I like that concept of the nodes. And then hopefully the influence areas beyond that, because you can see where you can walk within those circles fairly easily. It's not always the most pleasant walk. Some places are better than others, but you can do it.
I mean, you could scribble the barriers on here.
Okay, there's a lot of barriers.
Something we got to talk about in this neighborhood is here's a museum and a library. And that's, again, so underutilized, and imagine if this really becomes part of a neighborhood as opposed to just somewhere you go.
Well, although we were talking about this is highly, it's one of our highlighted areas here.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. We didn't even mention it, but we didn't even mention it. It being
it's
part
not
of
well
this.
Connected.
It's not
connected.
Not like
no, that. I think you'll see, you know, for repeating the theme, I agree, this is a jewel that's hidden, not utilized. This whole area, and then coming this way, this whole L shape, is really the meat of our community.
Yes.
And this is just the jobs.
Yeah, I mean, it's got our 1, 2, 3. One thing you might have done with a slight criticism, should add another color, circle this. I can see, you know, this could be a future noble area here, one here. We've got some gaps here, and some potential.
You're right, because I think we just went as far as Hudson Garden, and they just circled there.
You know, the talk around the city, around the country is TOD. That all this development is going to occur around the TOD. I think that's where, transit-oriented development. I think that's very limited. It really should just be nodal-oriented development, because there's other catalytic type of developments that can create higher density around them. Mm-hmm. I mean, we're, you know, these are nodal developments. These are transit developments, but it's all core development-oriented.
I think the river becomes river development, right?
Yeah.
So it's
because
there's accessibility here in ways not only from train and stations we have here and here, but then all of the bike paths and that we have.
If we want to promote our city as a place where we want developers who have quality developments, we need to begin to communicate how we are wanting them to come and use our river, use our nodes, use our intersections, and we're here to help you develop
those. So, see, this whole corridor here being, a stranger comes down, oh my God, it's an oh my God area, this whole corridor, and oh my God, maybe I want to live near it. And then there's the secondary oh my God downtown. There's the, you know, we've got two oh my Gods here. One pretty well developed downtown, one highly developed.
I use that in terms of a good experience.
Oh my God. Oh my God, I'm hugging you. Oh my God, I'm out of here. Oh no.
You know what's interesting though, right now they would say that if all they're doing is driving down Santa Fe.
Santa Fe, yes. The experience.
It's when they get off of Santa Fe, which is hard. You have to get on foot to get off of Santa Fe. And they see this, because I've experienced that, oh my God.
You find these
nooks and crannies of, oh my God, I can't believe this is my backyard. How lucky am I?
But you know, it's backyard alley of Littleton has got to become our problem.
You know, something that might be a wonderful detail down the road, I'm pushing, and we talked about it, and that is, you talk about it in terms of a shuttle. But Santa Fe is not a road you want to walk on. Mm-hmm. But if there was a way on the west side of Santa Fe to create a pedestrian connection, then because people don't know that you can get over here and walk if they don't live here.
Right.
But if there was a way to create another pedestrian link, like sidewalks that are separated from the high-speed traffic, you know, every development should have some sort of connectivity. You'd have this loop system that you could walk and get in.
Yeah.
I see it more as a center spine.
Somewhere
they're trying to walk along Santa Fe.
Whether it's on there or
but
it's
on
it's
you
know,
if you
have
a location where you can park and then you walk up a 100 yards and go in, or go in here, go back and forth.
You guys get the connection
letters?
We've got
Dallas.
Okay.
Listen,
let's get yours.
So they get the big picture.
So we look at zones and try to group our transformative sites into zones. And so we looked at zone one as really being the Littleton
Central Platte Valley, and really creating this river corridor that has businesses, it has mixed-use shops, recreation, and we looked at areas that were already assets from the mall to, well, let's see, we also have Riverside Downs anchoring and Hudson Gardens, and we've got the seminary. And so then we looked at, well, where are our transfer sites along the way that aren't developed? And this is a really big opportunity for a gateway. The Echo Star property, right downtown, the river, it's really visible from Santa Fe, and that it starts to tie in a lot of our city together. And then this is what we were talking about with that corridor, of having some type of transportation area, a path that you can go, or road system that's separated from Santa Fe, and they could have your golf cars, shuttle system, but just a way to have people walk, not just walk and bike, but also be able to have some type of transportation that has wheels that you can get from place to place faster. And then, so the second zone is... This is hierarchy. So number one is looking at, we heard a lot about an outdoor Littleton, and that this could be one that the community would really want to buy in and invest, because it's going to be fun. It's going to be and invest in the waterfront. And so two is the downtown area. And so we see that these are closely tied together, and they work together, the connection. And really then, again, the gateway, bringing people from Santa Fe down to downtown, and then continuing the main street through Littleton Boulevard. That's three. That's zone three. And then zone four is Broadway, and looking at the business opportunities. The Marathon site you highlighted, the hospital is already an asset. And then five is looking at the gem with the museum, the library, a park space, but it's just embedded, and there's not a clear way to get from our primary circulation routes here. And so we want to get connections to downtown, or connection to Littleton Boulevard, but there's a connection where people know in our community that this is exactly where our library and our museum is. And then the next, we've got more than five, but six is the housing, looking at the whole inner part of our square, basically, and the housing opportunities, and looking at, because it's such great access to these zones, and trying to capitalize on the housing that is here, and to have more options available. We did highlight the trail system in green. Dashed is bike circulation on the road that's decent. Jobs, this is a job-based area to highlight. And so what else do you want to mention?
One point that is obvious to me along here, this I just consider this to be a, let's call it a recreational business retail mall. And the typical mall has an anchor on either end, streets and south ends like that. Here's our anchor. Here's our future anchor.
Yep.
Incredible opportunities down here that will define our city for the next 60 years. That's so important.
Yeah. We did highlight the light rails stations as well. And taking advantage of those too.
You know, there was talk about the quarter mile, they're called pedestrian shifts in the transit world, being able to walk to transit. The minute we put those on there, we got opposition. Everybody put the transit on there.
It is.
There's not a circle. There's no that is, there's no... But the idea is you create core development, and I don't care if you're a quarter mile, a half mile, or a block, you're going to go to the core development if there's enough activity.
And you can bike there, too, but there's
yeah,
a
so it's not a, it's not a circle, it's a core node of activity that we want to encourage development, and then and to hopefully, not to use the word high density, but denser housing would be in that same general area. Because without that new housing and the new people, we're not going to be able to support these nodes and retail and jobs.
What's interesting about it is, you know, when you look at the aerial photo and all the maps and even our diagram, is it feels very somewhat urban. And the way you guys drew this, it feels very, very organic. You're really playing on the sort of natural geology, geography, hydrology, the whole, the linear system of the South Platte River and then its tributaries, and then. Yeah, the grid is overlaid on there, but it's very subtle and kind of in the background. And some of these, it's just, I like the way that it kind of picks up on the natural geography of the city.
Well, what was it, Tom, called the Platte Beachfront?
Yeah.
Beachfront.
And wonderful village.
Really, this is literally our beach. This is our upland. Everything flows to the beach.
So you're pretty snooty if you live up in the hills.
But to add to that, how nice that the mountains are over there, right? That
right.
makes sense. You
right.
always have Ooh. That view. Yeah. And it's just, yeah. And I really like how you pointed out the the anchor to both of it, because what's important about that, what I do like about how you guys carve this out, is this needs to be looked at holistically. It's not about this or just about that. Because if it's just about this and that, you kind of lose your way, right? And what I'm hearing you say is this all needs to be cohesive so you always feel like you're in Littleton. So whether you're here, or here, or here, you know you're in Littleton. There's something distinct and unique.
Let me bring up something that when I first joined the Planning Commission, we did the Santa Fe Corridor study. I don't know if you ever looked at the map. The flaw of that study, 15 years later that I see is we were studying the corridor.
Right.
We weren't looking. Yep. We were looking here out, not here
yep. Yep.
out.
Right.
Yep.
So it needs that. If we look at it again and with our comprehensive plan, it is this, but it's also it's in and out.
I was thinking the same thing.
Yeah.
That's what I keep hearing us talk about. Well, we focus on the Santa Fe corridor, and I think what we're saying now is no, we're focusing on the river. And Santa Fe happens to be the road that runs through it.
Right.
right?
Yeah, exactly.
And that's just time, experience, and...
I think a paving company has a charge.
The developers will and must orient to Santa Fe in terms of exposure and visibility, but they also need to turn to the west in terms of pedestrian orientation and access to recreation. I'll give you an example of me living in Littleton as a cyclist. I live here, I get on the Highland Canal, I come over to here, I go down to here. Sometimes I'll stop at Panera and have a bagel, or I keep going and I stop at the little shop at Hudson Gardens and get a drink, or I keep going and go down to the shops up in France there and get a donut.
Grasp of the obvious. This is not just Littleton or half mile radius. This is regional.
really big regional, plus the light rail, killer amenities, views, river, great access.
It's got every traffic patterns galore.
Dad, God, what else is, what a regional, unbelievable site.
Why isn't it developed yet?
Because it's had a lot of money for property and it's got some water issues.
Yeah. What is six again?
Housing, that's
our housing. Housing more diversity.
We have to put something in the middle of 90% of
that. That diversity could happen here, here,
yes.
Here.
I don't think there is.
Here, yeah. Littleton Boulevard.
I'm not sure what the opportunity here. Like, this feels like it's there.
Yeah, it's,
I mean,
it's
doesn't mean neglected. There's probably something worth looking at, you know, especially as you had that McMansion run for a while. You probably want to manage that a little better. So to keep the character of these neighborhoods, that's also a very distinct Littleton. But when I think of housing, to me, it's not just here. It's housing begins to, we have to relook at housing.
Call it inner housing, you know, inner housing and then green housing. We can talk to you about.
Why don't we talk about like the housing? I mean, this is all about the city, throughout the city.
Right.
So.
The housing, the mix and throughout the city.
Really, right? Yeah. It's really.
I think that what happens with housing is from a comp plan level, we're dealing with. Identifying land uses in areas
that can also
that will promote development. What happens after that is that Littleton becomes a place where people want to be. Then they start buying houses and renovating them, expanding them, scrape offs or pop tops or whatever it might be. And that's when this area begins to change. And
but those are still going to be R1 to R3.
Yes.
It's not going to change much.
No.
These other
We'll probably have a
housing map. I can see a separate, stable inner ring housing. Then we'd have housing, higher density. So we'd have different colors on the ring.
The edges.
Yeah, and opportunities like big opportunity here, need it, whatever. And then here's this kind of central stable area that's not going to change much. We're not going to mess with zoning. Way we get away with
it. Guys are
not to be drawn
to these black circles. Are they supposed to be a similar type?
Yeah, so those are city assets that are already there and that to connect to.
We didn't get all
hospitals.
I mean, downtown's a city asset, but
that was like our zone. I mean, I guess you're right, that could be highlighted in black.
So black dots too, as well as red dots.
I mean, that's,
you guys need more color. we identified where all the schools are, but we're not going to have any influence on schools. But it just shows that we have schools that's distributed throughout our community. Those are parks, larger parks connected by the canals and trails.
So I like that, Randy, as you said, it's here, right? Whether we look at it here, we look at it there, it's L. Here.
Yeah, it's there.
And so I think.
There's a theme for it.
There's key buzzwords. There's a Littleton L. There's the dead end on either end, Main Street. What do I call it? The moated downtown. What do we call this thing? That kind of buzz expression.
I think that's where, as we really think about now tactically building on this comprehensive plan, this is what we have to absolutely get right.
Right.
So if we're going to focus our efforts, this is what it has to be.
Doesn't that begin to play into the goals? I mean, the goal would be, to promote community riverfront development, blah blah, create linkages to nodes, things like that.
Identity, gateway.
Demand that anything here orient partial orientation, equal orientation to the river along, as well as the road. Demand it.
And I think another, what's really great about this is just as we've identified it as the biggest opportunity, it actually is those areas that are ready to be developed. As opposed to saying, if we were to say this is the biggest area opportunity, we're not ready to be developed. They're already established. Like, we really, it's an opportunity, one, because there's a river, two, because it's close to downtown. So independently of whether it was ready or not, it was an opportunity. So we have two things going for ripe for development. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of sites along here that are
screaming. Dennis, has there been a study been done on Santa Fe in terms of controlled access? Because I think that's the biggest barrier to Santa Fe development is access points.
Right. There is, and in fact, CDOT actually has a list of additional points that they can get at some intersections. They're trying to eliminate any access points that currently aren't controlled. So I think they're called. They've eliminated a lot of them either. It used to be just every you said it's a driveway. So eventually they'd like to consolidate those.
So the forcing us basically to do some inner streets here. I don't think we can connect it all the way through because of the housing here or Hudson Gardens being stop it. But
right. If there's no alternative,
you have to walk around to get to your next golf cart.
So Jenny, you're kind of like the mall ride.
Yes,
small shuttle, 16th Street, but more of like a smaller scale,
a little trolley,
like the little.
There's these low speed vehicles, and they are shuttles. You can get up to like 20 people, and they're enclosed. You can get enclosed once for like $23,000. It could be like that, but they're narrow. These are not like the mall shuttles, and they go slower too. Mm-hmm. So. They'd be more pedestrian and bicycle friendly, and there's even some electric, yes, and so they're clean, there's even some low speed vehicles that are shuttles that can get up to 12 people, and there's even handicap accessibility ones where you can get people on and off. So
I'm sure there's grants and funding that we can.
Well, some cities like Denver have transportation districts, what are they called? There's one around Cherry Creek.
What are they called?
Transportation Solutions or something.
Right. Is the name of that particular one. They're called, I can't remember. But that basically what they do is they work with larger employers and try to figure out how do we encourage carpooling. They're the ones that work with RTD to get the shuttles and subsidize the mission because they're expensive. Yeah, TMOs and TMAs.
That's what I was trying to think.
So it's called TMAs?
TMAs or TMOs, depends on where you are.
To take that a step further, find out what RTD bus routes do to see if we could create some sort of little loop that would just give a continuous route through our community to take people to all these nodes. Trolley or a shuttle or whatever.
It's like the double decker bus.
A little to get on and off.
The double L.
Isn't that Chicago has the L? Mm-hmm. Is that right?
Yeah.
Elevator. The
Littleton
L. There's a slogan or something.
I think well,
I guess so. One of the outcomes of the plan could be to recommend sub-area plans, and we've done, you mentioned the Santa Fe corridor plan that was done a long time. It was on our list as one of the highest priorities to do after this plan, but I think what I'm hearing is maybe it's the South Platte River corridor plan. And like you said, it's Santa Fe.
Which happens to have a road at the edge.
Yes.
Julie. Would it be possible, Dennis, to take a photo of both of these and send it to us as a JPEG or something?
Yeah.
Can you remember? This is really neat, both of these.
Yeah.
Honestly, I don't think they're too far apart either.
A lot of overlap.
For those that have been around longer than me, thinking like another type of resident, are there going to be those who look at that river corridor and say, great, now you're going to have three times as many people on that route. You're going to overrun it. Sure. How do you regulate and address that?
Well, number one, you've got the zonings in place quite a bit already. Mm-hmm. So use by right, quite frankly, is there. Mm-hmm. So
I think we have transit we didn't have before that is an offset or alleviates some of those concerns we would have had.
This has got to
PD in place. It's not a good PD.
Saturday mornings on the summer day are pretty crowded already. But that's not just Belgium.
That's right. This is a whole
Denver.
It's like a bike highway.
Yeah, you go through San Antonio, or the Riverwalk.
Right.
On a Saturday night, it's hard to walk out.
Right. But sometimes crowds mean revenue.
So we talked about outsourcing, you know, what's the right partnership with the organizations, et cetera. The revenue from here is to support the sustainability of this environment. So it's getting the right partnership so that it's viewed as a partnership and not battle.
Yeah, I think the uses by right are the main argument to do this. Mm-hmm. It's because without doing this, it can be done. Something else can be done that might not be so desirable.
So that leads directly to does our zoning allow us to regulate what goes there? Use by right is just by use. It doesn't say what type or how it looks and how it is oriented to the river. It doesn't have those form-based codes that help shape that.
Well, I guess the solution is for pushing towards PDs, you know. That's simple. And you can almost do that with any large project anymore anyway.
Really, you have the design guidelines that are in place for all the projects that are on the corridor itself. So it ends up looking like Altasca Grove or Altasca Grove itself. It has that rural vernacular, which I think is working pretty well for us. Again, it sets us apart. Oh, that rages.
The barnyard vernacular.
But the problem with the PD is I think it leans too heavily on the policy plans that are in place, which is the comp plan, which we don't really have right now. But in the absence of or in addition to the comp plan, we see this South Platte River Corridor plan, which would then prescribe the conditions that the PD would be approved under. Mm-hmm. Where the other thing we're talking about is the city of Aurora is doing this, what they call SIR zone. It's a new mixed-use zone. It's sustainable infill redevelopment. And they're using it for targeted areas that are underutilized, like specifically the city of Aurora. And it's a new zoning category that they're just now kind of actually using it in one of our projects, which is right adjacent to Stapleton, where the uses were all industrial. They were associated with the airport. Now the airport's been gone for more than 10 years, 15 years. They're impractical uses. It's big industrial buildings with contaminated soils. So they're looking for it's a mixed use, higher density, walkable, with a balance of open space. I think that's the selling point, is where the environmental constituency, which validly wants to preserve wildlife habitat and so on, clean water, you balance that with redevelopment, and there's trade-offs. So you get higher density, maybe up in Santa Fe, you get increased buffers, or tapering down toward the
I think that's a great approach
for
something like that, because I think when it's PD, it's always much more subjectivity, each one. And also, it puts the developer as more pressure and as more risk in a certain sense, because he doesn't know, or she doesn't know going in what's going to happen. Are they going to, is this going to be flagged? Right. I'm not going to be able to develop it. Whereas if there is that zoning, it says, I know I can do this higher density. I know I can deal with the parking's going to be looked at differently. Maybe the parking requirements. Maybe there's different ways to address the parking because there's creative parking strategies. And so so they don't have to walk in like Nevada Place and have the stress of, am I going to get turned down? Because it doesn't, I'm not compliant. Asking for more in certain areas, whereas someone can walk in and go, well, I feel pretty confident because I'm asking for what's zoned and should be able to be approved.
Mm-hmm. And then also, by creating that zoning, we get the acceptance from the community as well, right? So they're understanding what we're changing this to. It's a way to show what our vision is going to be for the whole corridor, not a certain plot of land. That's always been a challenge for us. But it was just for us, the community, the developer, we always talk about that plot of land, but we don't see it in the greater vision, or we're always having to
welcoming the opportunity to come to us as it becomes available.
And keep in mind, you know, we've got this and this to a smaller, this is sexy, but this is real important. That's three, that's four. But and we have done some studies partially along those boulevards. There's an old Broadway corridor study that could dust off and probably take a look. I don't think it was ever adopted by city. It was written on it. It needs greatly updating. But, you know, we're in danger here. We've got a 1981 comprehensive plan that doesn't address these visions we have. We've got to get this thing done in place and ready for what's going to happen along here and here and Broadway.
And also set the stage for where zoning will be updated, because there's got to be a better way that these PD plans or projects go through that are zoning more applicable for the higher density. And that we aren't trying to determine parking and trying to determine plan by plan what's appropriate. We've been looking at it and we have a better idea of what is appropriate in certain areas.
Well, the next layer of this is to superimpose the current land use map on it. And then begin to look at where you need to expand a certain zone categories to allow a bigger development area or reduce other areas or keep them where they are.
Dennis, what would be the sort of mechanics of creating a new zone district in the city? How daunting is that?
Well, it's pretty daunting. Yeah. 6 years?
That's the whole zoning code.
That's the whole zoning code. So they did both the codes and also did the map. And the map actually went much more easily than I thought it would. I thought that the map would be tougher than the code itself. But you know, we have a much simpler situation. We don't have the terrible disconnect between our existing zoning and a lot of the existing land use. So our existing residential neighborhoods are pretty well set in terms of what you want is probably in place with the existing zoning for the most part.
I guess what I'm thinking, because there is some, I think, pushback on the idea of strict form-based code, Denver and Miami and some cities have adopted. But what I was mentioning about Aurora having a new type of zone district that specifically targets redevelopment and mixed-use redevelopment that we don't have right now.
Well, I think that's the idea. What we're probably, we know which areas probably were lacking, areas along the corridor. That's where what Tom and Chuck both were saying is, if you have your vision in place, that's more than half the battle. So you have your vision for what you want to happen in these areas, and then you can put the regulations together that meet those. And that's not a huge process. It gets into, are you taking stuff away from expectations away from property owners? Are you changing that? And if you are you provide some kind of trade-off, it's so it's in this case, I think the 81 plan is so out of sync with what the current market is and the vision for the community is that I can't imagine some kind of anything but beneficial officer back along there to see something done.
My vision is to get what we want, but also make developers very successful and make them a pile of money. Make money, they're happy, they do a better job, they improve their properties. It's all good for
them. Great. And
great combination.
That can happen. Yeah, absolutely. Because the biggest thing developers particularly want to know is,
give me some set of rules.
What do you want, and I will get it.
Put it in writing.
Yeah.
And stick
it may not be what I wanted ideally, but if it's simpler, because this is what you want, and you're going to facilitate it for you. And you work together. Yeah.
So do we feel as a group that we've established some priorities that Dennis can take? Do you feel like a top five?
We have two different sets, I think, in terms of numbers, but I think the lists are very similar, so we can work with those and come back and refine those.
I think in the last couple of months, or last 6 months, thinking about the new comprehensive plan, that we kind of things are cloudy, nebulous. Tonight, just all of a sudden, it's just kind of crystallized as to what's important. I mean, we try to come up with a color. What are eyesores? What are major big problems in Littleton? Couldn't find any really. major league problems. It was very interesting. So anyway, my mind is a lot more crystallized as to what this comprehensive plan is going to be. Very
well,
good
session.
So I'm looking at the comp plan. There's really no citywide future land use map.
No, there's not.
It really breaks it down into specific neighborhoods.
Certain neighborhoods with a lot of repetition.
Which doesn't give you a cohesive vision.
No. It was done from the bottom up, which is what I think the direction at that point was. A lot of communities were doing that. But it was really focused on the neighborhoods. Well, our neighborhoods really are pretty stable at this point. So I think what we're looking at doing is what we saw in D4 when we were doing the downtown plan. Was we really need that 30,000 foot level for what's the role of downtown for the city as a whole? What do we, does the city need it to be? What should it be? And how's it fit? And so then we can say, okay, everything else. So, yeah, you're absolutely right. It's, I think the challenge launching the plan was
three or four pages in the beginning, it talks about the city as a whole, and then immediately goes into that.
And Mark, I think they pulled it out later, didn't they? They did the neighborhood plans and then went back and pulled out the ones that, that they had in common so far.
It does have a sentiment corridor plan.
It was done later.
Right. Okay.
97
or something?
Yeah, I think so.
Whatever it was. 97.
But it focuses on specific land use parcels. Not the environment of corridor.
Well, not only that, but I think it was done prior to this huge shift in what the potential of Santa Fe seemed to be. It was a very different Santa Fe at that point. It really was the warehouse, office warehouse type of use that's going on in Santa Fe. It was before Aspen Grove was put in place, before the light rail and the gates. It should change dramatically. It used to be really a back door entrance to the city. It is pretty embarrassing.
What is this Chatfield Activity Center?
That's Trail Rock.
Oh.
And you'll notice that it has a very different format than the rest of the plan. It's basically the zoning, almost. It's a very specific plan for the development.
As Mark said, now the vision becomes clear, right? So in the pictures, it's clear to us. But I think our next step is really writing down that vision. So now that we have the picture in our mind, I think it's about beginning to formulate that sentence, that paragraph that sets the stage of this is the vision politically. And then from there, we can start building out then how we bring this vision to life. And that's when we start talking about Zone 1, Zone 2, Zone 3,
whatever. Right. And Glenn and I'll take a shot at that and work with Greg and get
back. Oh, for the benefit of the TV audience, I apologize if you're still with us. We probably haven't been able to hear that conversation for the last 45 minutes, but here are two maps that we've generated around the idea of priority. Focus areas, transformative projects, and staff will be working to sort of consolidate those. Let's see, what else do we have? I wanted to just go back to that question because it may come up, and it should be addressed in the plan of whether we're all okay with the current borders of Littleton. I know the issue has come up with Sterling Ranch. Are there other areas that are contiguous to Littleton that may come calling at some point, perhaps not even initiated by the city, to opt in or annex in? Is there any benefit to addressing that in the plan, or do we ignore it, or say, no, the existing boundaries are good. It seems that the benefit would be to annex retail properties that would benefit the tax base.
Oh, exactly.
Ranch. Why pull out that way?
It's for the ranch. What do we want that for? From having more specific direction, one or the other.
Right. Yes, from the comp plan. Right?
South of Sheffield.
It just got a big defeat.
Way south.
Yeah.
The water.
They didn't grant.
You rejected the water.
They ruled that they must prove they have water for the entire development. Just phase by phase. So they got to have water up front.
there's a concept.
That's, yeah, that's going to be the problem.
Just so I understand better how that works. So does it have to be, like, could we, and that, could Centennial come to us and say, I want to be part of Littleton, or is it those areas that are unincorporated?
Probably the unincorporated areas.
Jeffco going out.
And there may be some gaps between us and Centennial, I doubt it. But, you know, it's really Jeffco.
Jeffco.
South of Lakewood.
And typically, if you look at grids, same thing we were talking about, where you make your money is not off the property taxes, particularly not residential properties. So you're looking for commercial properties, industrial properties. You're looking for properties that are going to generate the revenue to pay for the services that you're providing. Cities in Colorado typically show it.
Yeah, I think some of those opportunities now, so can we identify where some of those opportunities may be?
Well, probably south on Santa Fe would be a
valley.
I'm
looking all about it right now.
Yeah.
That's, don't mess up our mind.
So we need like a Littleton tech park?
Is that the brown, right? Yeah. He's the brown.
Very light. I think Conlon Drains is going to let us get away with it.
So that's Douglas County now, right?
Was that
So that's not part of Highlands Ranch now?
Highlands Ranch is not incorporated.
It's not incorporated.
It's
not
incorporated. It's a metro district. That's where the quarry is, or there's a rock place.
Ashland is the park.
Yeah, that's the park.
But it's a good dog.
It's south of
470. So there's a lot of commercial uses in there, a lot of industrial uses.
And the city didn't look at that. They actually looked at this area south of C-470 for 10 years or so ago. And at that point, the thought was it was going to be so expensive to go in and bring the infrastructure that was there already up to city standards that it was going to not make sense, at least in the short term.
Does that belong to
them? It's Douglas County.
Douglas County. I don't know where Jack Owen starts, but somewhere over here?
Yeah, somewhere over here.
And so is it a single city, or is it?
It's not. It's not over there.
Now Lockheed Martin is
They're further down. And there's actually a fairly big commercial node here at Kipling.
But annexing all of that out there, you can build those houses, which you don't want. They take more services.
I see that being an opportunity.
I don't see anything else other than that. And
I don't see it makes sense.
We have a city of
75,000.
We
have
to send them all out very well. Beaumar is incorporated.
Correct.
Columbine Basin.
Columbine Valley.
With our Navy.
Yeah.
I imagine there's some overhead costs associated with operating a municipality that's in two or three counties, correct?
I think so. And when they were looking at Sterling Ranch, my understanding was that they were talking about actually contracting for some of those services. So it didn't make sense for the city to provide all the services because it's so far out. Same arguments we hear from folks who live here is that they're concerned about the response time for fire, they're concerned about. And so it's just so far away, does it make sense to put somebody that's here to build another substation out here? How do you do that? Or do you contract with Douglas County or some special district center to do that? At what point? It seems like one thing we might think about doing in the plan would be at least to develop a set of criteria for what you guys think makes sense in terms of what should be considered. If you're going to look at annexation or if you're going to be proactive or reactive in a way, what are the criteria?
I would say anything that's wouldn't consider anything that's not contiguous. So it has to be large.
Yeah, by law, it has to be contiguous.
Well, how does that be
compared? I hear he has a strange definition. This is it's
open space. Open space.
Probably didn't flagpole.
No, they flagpoled out here, but they didn't. They didn't have to flagpole out here too much. They actually went right across the river. Down and then could do it in sections. They had to have a certain percentage contiguity so they could make the first chunk down and then they'd have to annex that and then annex farther. So it's
as we think about annexation of this property here,
Is that a proactive strategy to gain something, or is it a defensive strategy to prohibit something from happening?
Both. yeah,
I'd say both. The other thing, it's partially financial, but I think something Littleton has that certainly needs is a sense of community, this very strong sense of community. And I don't know that we want to do anything that's going to jeopardize that. And I don't know how you can have something way down here that's going to ever feel like part of it.
I think we stay the, what do you call it, a small town and a big city. That's what we want to stay.
Yeah. I mean, the question is, can we stay sustainable, viable, if we don't grow? And if we don't grow geographically, how do we grow internally? Or do we keep changing, or what do we do? And that's where you get into infill development and actually some other changes over time. Or do you need that? I mean, I think that's a question. Or
you know, need reinvestment. How much time do we gain? I mean, so this is our next big thing, right? Because there's a lot of space, et cetera. What does that buy us? 20 years, 50 years, 100 years? Right? That's almost the way we look at it.
20 years.
Because, again, we don't have of sustainability, financially viable, all of those things.
Or you just face it and say, then at some point, then you start looking at you know, other areas that you develop, or at some point, you just keep improving existing areas. Some places have been stable for hundreds of years, and there's infill and there's reinvestment, but it doesn't mean they've ever grown much necessarily.
Well, yeah, I guess as long as there is a good balance of commercial workplace and residential, and it feels like we have a pretty good balance.
The ratio is unbelievable. Jobs to population, 1.3 to 2 versus Denver, Aurora, and Broomfield, 0.95 to 2.
The region.
Yeah, the region, right. The region versus just Littleton.
And I think given where we're located, because we are in Phil, again, it creates that opportunity for people are coming to us. So even if, they're not living there, they're still coming to us. And so I agree. I think there probably is a lot of longevity to what we're going after here. This is very appealing, though, right? It's the last center frontier for Littleton.
Actually...
Not that.
Yeah. And so why do you do that?
Office, car dealer, apartments, it's a mix of office and population. Industrial.
You need to join another golf course, right?
It also
send in the Navy, huh?
Yeah. It would create kind of a foundation to our employment base in one area,
moving everything.
But a major gateway.
Yeah, you get control over those gateways.
I think we should take a serious look at that.
That's right. No, light rails coming back over here.
Yummy.
Where's the actual station going to be?
So it's south of Seaford.
That would be all the reason to do it.
There's enough land there to do some garages and.
It's going to be south of that.
It's further south.
So it's north of Target.
North of Target.
A chunk of land available for.
There's a lot of land.
Oh, so you get a Target, too.
You would even pull up. Target further down. You don't want to annex the Highlands Ranch Town Center.
We could rebrand it.
Moso. Or Lissa. Lissa.
Lissa.
No, that probably wouldn't work. I mean, even that quarter right there, that's a little different, but. But you don't have to get the agreement of these people, this is us. Correct. All you need is the agreement of these people.
The people on the other side of the
What is it? You got to get adjacent people to agree to? Or?
No, just the people in the other side. I think, unless you're annexing another county, I think. Is that right?
Yeah. Well, one of the things that struck me about the data that you presented before, Dennis, was the number of people that work in Littleton and live in Highlands Ranch. I think that was a high number as far as the in commute. So that adjacency is important.
Yeah. Be interesting. So are those people in Helen's Wake? So it'd be interesting to see, you know, what are the benefits of living in City of Highlands Ranch versus City of Littleton. So kind of, you know, to understand what would we be facing if we were to go there. Like,
I've never heard any discussion of incorporation. Is anybody else for Highlands Ranch? Is it here?
Centennial gobble them up eventually.
If you live there, you pay that usually.
Yeah.
Anyone from across the city, across the unincorporated area format.
Actually, there's a no-man.
Then they can come to, you know, Littleton Schools, which are fantastic.
Highlands Ranch only starts on the south side of C-470. This area is a no-man's land.
And it's in Douglas County.
It's Douglas County. Yeah. It's nobody. So that would be a logical, easy take. Playing risk.
Here we go.
Then my arm is done right here.
Look at it.
We just started working. Created welcome working.
You better adjourn or we'll be invading Denver here.
Okay, well, let's see, any closing thoughts? Hey, one thing I wanted to ask is, Jenny, we've been putting your presentation on hold,
right, and
I was thinking, would the beginning of the next meeting make sense?
Sure.
Would you be available to do it then?
Yes.
I think I talked to Glenn about it a little bit. It seemed to make sense as far as how much more work we have. Mm-hmm. It's about a half hour, 45
yes,
minutes?
Yes, about half hour.
Okay.
Yeah.
So,
and it would give some ideas of some example case studies that would start to think about, like, what could this be? What could this be? There's some examples in there that would be interesting, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Just to look at other cities in the metro and Colorado. So.
Mm-hmm.
Lots of pictures.
Yeah, so let's plan on that. Let's try and do the same schedule if that works for everybody, and we can have food again.
Food is great.
So,
yeah, what
is that? Dory?
She cooked it?
Oh, no, she cooked it. Sorry. It was, I want to say three tomatoes, but it's not quite right. The ones that usually do our catering.
Are they mostly little
things? Berries or?
No, same people that did the baked potatoes last time.
Well, they were strawberry something.
Strawberries. Not tomatoes, strawberries. Something like
biscuits.
I'm sorry.
Will we be in this room again? Or?
10, probably.
Okay.
10
to 6 o'clock. Like to be able to use the...
Do we want to use
the...
Okay. So, yeah, we'll have Jen's presentation for...
Is that right? Be able to use the PowerPoint?
Yes.
Okay.
So we're meeting at 6 to gain another dinner, or what are we doing?
Well, we're going to do 7.
Well, I think the agenda was for those goals and policies,
right?
Right,
I think you're right with the vision, and we could maybe start with the vision and then go to the goals.
But I have a feeling that a 2-hour time frame is going to be just enough.
Okay. Well, especially if she does her presentation.
Right. So go for 3?
Yeah, if that works for everybody, okay. Start at the same time.
At the same time?
Yeah.
6?
Right.
Sure. And that's 2 weeks from tonight?
Yeah. So, any other inputs? Otherwise, a motion to
adjourn.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Thank you, John.
Thanks.